Today I want to share with you some of my favorite tips and techniques for working with Atelier Interactive Professional Artist Acrylics. Atelier Interactive has a patented formula which allows artists to use both their standard acrylic painting methods as well as explore new, slow, controlled methods of working wet and wet and blending. It's the only paint that offers artists both options, both ways of painting, using your traditional techniques or exploring these new techniques, and even combining them all into make a new fantastic painting. The following ways are not the only techniques that you can use with Atelier Interactive and its mediums, but they're some of my favorite ways, and I hope that they will inspire you to explore some methods on your own. My first step for acrylic painting success is to prepare your surface. What do I mean? I mean gesso it. What gesso does is that it helps to protect your surface from the layers of paint that you're going to put on top of it. It's going to have a nice grit content so that your paint can adhere, and it can also provide that nice opaque ground that can be very helpful when you're beginning a painting. Now, many of us like to buy pre-primed or pre-gessoed surfaces, but adding a layer of Atelier gesso or Atelier liquid gesso will vastly improve that surface. In a case like I have here, I'm actually using a pre-primed surface that I already did a painting on that I didn't like. So I already applied one coat of our Atelier gesso, and you can see with just one coat how nice and opaque it is. In this case, I'm going to apply a second coat, and I'm using one of my painting knives, and you can see that our Atelier gesso has that nice content. It's that nice and really provides a good textural surface if that's what I want. You do not need to use a knife. You can certainly use a brush, but sometimes I find that using a knife helps spread it and can give it a little bit more of that texture. Usually, if you're going to re-prime and prepare a surface yourself, usually about two coats. Maybe you might want to sand in between coats. If you do choose to sand, make sure that you're wearing the proper ventilation or respirating equipment, the proper mask. Not good to get that kind of little fine particles into your lungs. There we go. So two coats, and this is going to be a nice bright white, and on a failed canvas I didn't like too much, I now have a brand new surface that is ready for me to paint. On this watercolor paper, I'm going to use our Atelier liquid gesso. Now both Atelier gessos, the regular Atelier gesso as well as the liquid gesso, are flexible, so you can put them on canvas and enroll it. But I like to use the liquid gesso on paper because it's a little bit thinner. It's still going to provide that nice opacity and that tooth, but I can make it nice and smooth here. You can see I'm using a painting knife to smooth it out. I could do this on a canvas as well. But the reason I like to especially use the liquid gesso on paper is because it's a little bit thinner. So when I go plein air painting, or when I'm doing studies, or if I'm just painting on the go, I can still take surfaces that are already prepared and ready to go with me, but they're not going to be as big, and they're going to be a little bit more lightweight, not as heavy. All considerations when you paint and travel, or just want to get down to it in the studio. The next tip is to tone your ground. Now, this is a step that is traditionally taken by oil painters. And what toning your ground does is that you are applying a mid-value wash of color to your surface, something that you will be able to use to help judge your highlights and your lowlights, your brightest whites and your darkest darks, against that mid value. Traditionally, this color has been something along the lines of a yellow ochre or a burnt sienna or a raw sienna or even a French ultramarine blue. But you don't always have to stay with those colors. You can definitely punch it up a little bit. I am someone that likes to take it up a notch or two. I tend to use a brighter color for my underpainting for the way that I tone my ground. And I like that because you always see color in relation to color. And it's when you add these layers and layers and layers of color do you start to achieve that luminosity, which is just beautiful. So what I like to do in this step where I am turning my ground, I already have my gessoed surface. I'm going to use some of the binder medium. The binder medium is an acrylic emulsion and it is going to seal the surface and it's going to make my atelier interactive, non-interactive, so I don't have to worry about layers opening up. I'm going to find that my subsequent layers of paint that I put on top are going to grip really well too. All I'm going to do is just put a little bit of binder medium off to the side. And then I'm just going to add a little bit of quinacridone magenta. I did say I liked a bright, punchy color. No raw sienna or yellow ochre for me, typically. Sometimes I do. In this case, I want to have a nice, bright color. And it's going to look pretty intense at the moment, but it's not really going to be that bad once you start to apply it. And this is a nice, semi-transparent layer of color, so this is going to really... Not only is this going to dry fast and dry hard, but it's really going to provide some nice contrast to the next layers of color that I put on top. In this case, I am applying it with a brush. You could use a palette knife if you really wanted to get some extra texture, but I'd probably just use an old choppier type of brush. Alright, my first layer of color is down. I no longer have to fear the white canvas, and I'll be ready to move on to the next stages of my Atelier interactive painting. Building on that initial ground that you put down, it can be very helpful to put in your masses to kind of define your shapes before you really start to get into the details. In a case like this, where you're putting your areas of lights and dark, your major masses, it can be helpful to use a low viscosity medium, something like the Atelier Fast medium, so you can put your shapes in and block them in really quickly. Because you're going to be building, or maybe you won't be, but I certainly like to build up all of my shapes through different layers, and I don't really get to a very painterly effect until later on in the painting. Right now, I just want to give myself a roadmap of where I'm going. So my fast medium is a nice low viscosity medium, so I can just add a little bit of paint and a little color here. And since I have this mid value going on, even though it's a punchier color, I can kind of judge where my lightest lights are and how they look in relation. So here I can see I probably need to add a little bit more, so I'm going to take a nice, there we go. So you can see how nice and fluid that's working. The fast medium is one of our most fluid of the painting mediums. I'm just going to kind of lock in, you know, my a sky area up in here. Again, I intend to go over this, you know, many more times as I build up my painting, but I just want to kind of get the general idea of where I'm going. Take some more fast medium. I'm going to just add it directly to my palette this time. I'm going to take a little bit of my ochre, mix it in, kind of get a nice earth tone. There we go. That's the value I'm looking for. Build in a shape. A good thing to know about the fast medium is that when you add it to Atelier Interactive, your layers are going to dry faster, thus the name fast medium. They're also going to get fixed. They're going to stay in place. So if you want to explore some of the wet and wet blending capabilities of Atelier Interactive, you will not be able to do so with water. You would need to use one of the other mediums in the line called the unlocking formula. And I'll get into that step a little bit later. Let's add a little bit more fast medium here, and let me work up a good rich dark here. a good violet. Take a little bit of my quinacria magenta, a little bit of my phthalo blue here, magenta. Mix it in with that medium. There we go. This is a good rich dark to kind of give me the idea. So now I've got different values happening on my surface. And like I say, it kind of points to the idea of what I'm going to want to do in this abstracted landscape. Now that I've got some more color added to my painting, what I want to do is refine my shades and really bring this to a next stage of completion where I have a little bit more depth, a little bit more focus, a little bit more intent. For me, when I do this stage, I love to use the clear painting medium. It's my favorite painting medium. I love it because it's a mid-viscosity medium. It makes the paint feel so smooth and silky, almost like painting with honey. The clear painting medium really is just does wonderfully well with Atelier Interactive. So you can use it in a few different ways. You can add it directly to your paint. You can apply it directly to your surface or and paint into it. And where you can even kind of just put it on top and kind of see how you can go with it that way. In this case, I'm just gonna add some here to my palette. It's off to the side. And I'm just gonna kind of dip my brush in as I need to. Now I'm gonna work on this goose over here. Bring up a little bit of, mix some more color in here. Maybe add a little bit of my transparent orange. That's a good color. Then I'm gonna dip some medium and then just kind of start to build this up. And then just kind of work on refining my shapes. We'll get a little bit of red in here, a little bit of crimson. The clear painting medium really helps to facilitate that blending. Again, it just makes your paint feel so nice and smooth. It's wonderful for wet over dry painting techniques, which is what I'm doing right now. Let's say I wanted to have this edge just kind of come out a little bit more, feather it out, so to speak. I could just use a little bit of my clear painting medium. Kind of put some on in here, and then by painting directly into the medium, let's start back here, you can see how it really just helps it flow. Like I said, it's one of my favorite painting mediums to use. Now, when it comes to using painting mediums, I would definitely encourage you to try a few different ones, because just because I prefer a certain painting medium, you might prefer using a different one. Maybe you prefer using our gloss medium, or a matte medium, or acrylic painting medium, or a universal medium. There's lots of different mediums that all differ a little bit in viscosity. Remember that painting medium's job are to alter or to enhance the properties of the paint. Bring this up a little bit redder here. And I know that geese typically aren't orange or pink or yellow, but in my world they are. Now, this leads me directly into tip number 5, which is all about blending. Typically, when you work with acrylics, they dry very fast, so you have a very, very short time in which you can blend. But what makes Atelier Interactive so unique is that it cures over time. So as you are painting, what you'll find is that you can actually control the drying process. All you need to do is just give it a little bit of water from a water sprayer, and your paint, you can keep working with it in a wet and wet fashion. Keep getting these nice, soft, subtle blends. And the key is in being able to feel what's happening under your brush. What will happen is that your paint's gonna go from nice and wet, then it's gonna start to feel a little bit sticky like it is here. It's starting to pull and drag just a little bit. It's at that draggy type of stage when your paint feels sticky, that is Atelier Interactive interacting with you. That is when you want to just spray with just a little bit of water, just enough to give it some moisture again, and you can see that the paint is going to go nice again, it's gonna go right back to that wet consistency so that you can keep blending and really develop very, very subtle transitions. And I can do this as long as I control the drying, as long as I add moisture. When I withhold the moisture, when I don't spray, my Atelier Interactive will go back to drying at its normal acrylic rate so that I can then overpaint, so that I can scumble, so that I can glaze, so that I can use all of my standard acrylic painting techniques. So it's the only paint in the world that can do both of these things. Let you use all of your standard acrylic painting techniques as well as explore these new wet and wet blending techniques. If you should miss that opportunity where your paint is already has dried, you know, try using water. You know, I find that water can typically reactivate touch dry paint for a certain period of time. How long is going to depend on your surface, your humidity, how thickly you've painted, and what mediums you've incorporated into the paint. Has it been more of a traditional medium, such as our binder medium, or our fast medium, or a matte medium, or a gloss medium? Or are they a more interactive medium, such as our clear painting medium? All of this information and more can be found on our website, which is atelieracrylic.com. What I mean by slow painting is that ability to really keep your paint wet so that you can keep blending, you can keep manipulating it for a long period of time. And plein air painting, of course, is painting outdoors. This was one of my plein air paintings, and I used a few things to really help me achieve these nice, soft, blended effects while I was painting outside. I incorporated some of our slow mediums, such as our liquid slow medium, or a thick slow medium. I also took along a water sprayer and a small bottle of the unlocking formula. The reason I use these is because when you are out in the sun, when you're out in the hot air, your paint is going to dry fast. That is the nature of acrylics on their own, and then you add in some other conditions with sun and wind and people stopping to talk to you, you're gonna find that you don't quite have the time that you wanted to paint. So by having some slow mediums, by having some water and some unlocking formula, I was able to keep blending. Let me show you how to use some of these slow mediums. We have a liquid slow medium as well as a thick slow medium, and they act the same. It's just they're going to differ in viscosity. They're the most re-wettable of the mediums. You can apply them directly to your paint, or as I like to do, I like to apply them directly to my surface. In this case, I'm going to use our liquid slow medium. I'm going to apply it to my surface. You might not be able to see it now. When I start to add some paint to it, you'll be able to see what really can happen. Put some paint right here. This is going to help me achieve these wonderful, smooth, gradiated effects. Great if you are painting large. Great if you are someone who likes to glaze, but you find that the open time of the acrylic glazing liquid or the universal medium or the gloss medium aren't quite as much as you need. Slow mediums you're going to want to try. Also, if you're in a very hot environment or you don't have a lot of humidity, you might also want to incorporate some of these mediums. A little will go a long way. You do not need much of these mediums at all, because you will find that even though your layers may dry fast, you can still just use a little bit of water if you need to, or a wet brush, and your paint is just going to go right back, as I pick some of that up, to being nice and super wet again. Like I said, these are great mediums for plein air, because when you are painting plein air, you usually are trying to capture those light effects. I mean, working wet and wet is a traditional way of working plein air. So that's, you know, just a little bit about, you know, our liquid slow. Now I'm just going to turn this upside down, and I'm going to show you our thick slow medium. Our thick slow medium again has the same properties as the slow, but it has more of the consistency of hair gel. So if you are someone who likes a really juicy paint, if you are someone who maybe comes from an oil painting background, you might prefer the thick slow medium. Again, you can add it directly to your paint, or in this case, like I am, adding it to your surface. I usually add some to my surface when I'm going plein air painting. And also, I like to add just a little dab to my paint when I have my palette all set up when I'm going plein air to help keep it nice and wet. Of course, I will use my water sprayer every so often and spray my palette just to make sure that my paints stay hydrated. There you go. Now you can see that you can see a little bit more of the brush stroke. You can see that with the thick, slow, medium, it keeps that nice impasto quality. It doesn't quite have that smoothness of the liquid slow medium. But still, I'm able to get some nice blended effects, be able to keep some of that painterly mark. And again, the medium that you prefer is going to be all based on your own particular style and technique, you know, what you like as a painter. So there you have it, liquid slow medium and thick slow medium. I showed you how you could blend using a water sprayer. Just notice when your paint starts to feel a little bit sticky or starts to drag under the brush, that's when you want to use your water sprayer. But maybe you've had to leave the area for a little bit, or it's the next day or two, maybe even 3 days later, and you come back to your painting and you're thinking, you know what I really want to do? I really wish that I could blend this area. You can always overpaint, because Atelier Interactive is an acrylic. You can certainly use your traditional acrylic painting techniques, but if you're thinking that you want to blend and water doesn't work anymore, that's when it's time to try the unlocking formula. The unlocking formula is isopropyl alcohol based. It's designed to be sprayed onto your painting to get layers to reopen when water doesn't work anymore. That's what I have in my little bottle here so I don't get confused. So I can just spray some unlocking formula on right in that area. I'll just take one of my brushes. And you can see that this paint, which is, gosh, hours and hours old, reopens so easily. Now, how long will this unlocking formula work? Kind of just like water. It's all going to depend on your surface, your humidity, how thickly you've painted, and what mediums you've incorporated into your paint. But this ability to kind of go back in and maybe soften some edges or add some new color in really makes Interactive such an incredibly versatile paint. Glazing is one of my favorite techniques because it involves adding transparent layers of color, one on top of the other, to really build up an incredibly luminous surface. It's an old master's technique, but it works great with contemporary techniques as well. What you want to do is use a transparent acrylic medium, and there's a few that you can choose among the Atelier line. Mediums such as our matte medium, our satin medium, our gloss medium, are my favorite, the acrylic glazing liquid. This is what I'm going to use to glaze my sky. What glazing will do, it will subtly enhance those colors. My sky area here is mostly opaque, a mixture of cad yellow deep and some cad yellow light, some Naples yellow, and it looks okay, but right around this head area, it's just a little too much the same color. So I want to increase the depth. I want to make this stand out a little bit more. Glazing is a great way. A good glazing ratio is about 9 parts medium to 1 part paint. I'm going to put some off to the side in a cup. Then I'm going to scoop a little bit of a transparent color. In this case, I'm going to use my quinacridone magenta. And I'm just going to mix it in. Stir it up real good. The acrylic glazing liquid, like most acrylic mediums, it's going to be milky, but it's going to dry nice and translucent. I'm going to make a nice glaze. Now, don't be surprised. Your glazes can look a little strong when you mix them up off to the side. I don't know if you can see this, but it looks pretty strong, but it's not going to be nearly intense. If you're afraid, you can always just practice a little bit off to the side on a scrap piece. So what you want to do is you want to get your glaze, and you want to have a rag ready as well. Because if it is goes on a little bit too intense, like it is here, I'm just going to wipe it back. And just kind of wipe some off. You can see how I'm just going to build up this depth of color. I'm using one of my softest sable brushes right now. You want to use a soft brush when it comes to glazing because you really don't want to have those brush strokes. You want to try and get this to be as smooth as possible. Now my surface is pretty textured, so that's another reason why it's good to just kind of smooth this out using my rag. Old t-shirts work really well for this, for the rag, so when you have all those t-shirts that you get paint on, don't throw them out. You can save them for your painting rags, save them for glazing rags. Now when you add a glazing medium like our acrylic glazing liquid to your paint, it's going to make the paint stay open just a little bit longer so you have some time to manipulate that glaze so you don't have to be so worried that it's going to dry super fast. You will have some time to manipulate it. If you find it's not enough time for your working methods, well, then you can just try another medium, such as one of our slow mediums. They work really well, our thick slow medium, or maybe our liquid slow medium, or even our universal medium. Now, one thing to note, that with the matte medium, with the satin medium, with the gloss medium, and with this medium, the acrylic glazing liquid, these are traditional acrylic painting mediums. They will allow you to work, you know, fast and layer quickly. And by that I mean that these layers, you're not going to be able to reopen again with water or the unlocking formula once they've dried and once they've cured. There you go. Just add a little bit more depth. And just by doing just a quick little glaze, it kind of brought out a little bit more around this goose. And I just don't have to keep this glaze right on top of the yellow. I can also bring some down onto the grass area. Because this brilliant magenta is more of a red tone, it's going to act as a complement to the greens, and it's going to kind of dull it. You can see how it's dulling it down, making this nice bright grass a little bit more of a neutral color, which isn't a bad thing. Now I want to have some neutrals in my painting. I don't want it always to be screaming. It's those grayer areas that's going to help balance out the really bright colors. Now it stands to reason that if you can open up your layers of Atelier Interactive so that you can blend, you can also reopen up your layers of Atelier Interactive so that you can remove some paint as well. I'm just going to spray a little bit of my unlocking formula onto here, and now taking a rag, I can actually start to remove some layers of paint. So you don't have to worry about messing up, because you almost always have a way that you can kind of backtrack and get back down to another layer of your work. And this is great not just for removing layers of paint, but also if I wanted to get back in here and create some more texture. There are lots of ways that you can add texture to an acrylic painting. You could use painting knives. You can build up your surface using lots of gessos or aggressive brush strokes. Or you can incorporate some texture mediums. In the Atelier line, we make a few of them. We make our regular gel, which is available in a gloss as well as a matte formula. We make a heavy gel, which is available in a gloss as well as a matte. And we make our molding paste. I'm going to show you the differences on these paintings. The first one is our heavy gel. Our heavy gel is going to be a milky gel, but it is going to dry transparent. It is very soft. You can apply this gel either with a brush or with a palette knife. You can apply it directly on top of your painting. You can mix it in with your paint. I'm going to mix it in with some paint. Now this is glossy, so it's going to, of course, be glossy, but it's also going to dry translucent, so I'm not going to have to really worry about that milky color. It's going to really create some nice impasto effects, and I'll just use my palette knife with that. You can see that it's holding some of that brush stroke and that brush mark. We'll put some up here so you can see it. And this is something that, again, you could use with a brush or with a painting knife. The next medium that I'm going to show you is our regular gel. And the formula I'm using here is a gloss, but of course it does come in a gel. This also is milky but will dry translucent. In this case, I'm just going to apply it directly on top of my painting. Now, why would I want to do that? Well, because it is milky, it was going to dry clear, but it's going to be nice and soft. And this is going to add just a little bit more texture because it's going to have some brush stroke on here as well. I could certainly mix this with my paint because the regular gel has a consistency of unpigmented paint. So this will help extend it, give me some more bang for my buck. I could do impasto glazes if I wanted with this. But in this case, what I'm looking to do is add texture. So I could add heavy texture with a heavy gel, or I could add some softer texture with a regular gel. We'll put that on there, and this will dry nice and clear. Now, if you really are looking for a lot of texture in your work, the medium that I would recommend would be our molding paste. Our molding paste is a calcium carbonate based compound, which means that it's going to dry opaque. So you have to be aware of that because the color can affect your values. This is something that is definitely stiff, and you either want to use a painting knife or a very old brush because it is pretty stiff. You don't want to use a nice brush when you're applying this. Again, I'm going to mix this with some paint. I'm going to mix some yellow here, and with my phthalo blue red shade, and I'm just going to scoop it up. Again, you can see how thick it is. It's really not moving, and I'll just apply some over here, and I'm just going to cover up my little goose's feet here so you can see how I'm able to sculpt and to really build up that texture. Now, all of these mediums are considered traditional mediums. So once they dry, you will not be able to reopen your paint, but because they are textural mediums, because they are so thick, you're going to find that you have more time to manipulate this because it's going to take longer to dry, because thick things naturally take longer to dry. Now, the molding paste is something that you can incorporate into your painting at any stage, just like the other mediums. You don't necessarily have to use this on top. I like to sometimes use this on my very first few layers and really build up my texture. Lately I've been into very textural surfaces. There we go. These are just some great, great ways to really build up that texture and really add that surface interest to your painting. Tip number 10 is about the final step to acrylic painting success, and that is varnishing your work. Now, We always recommend varnishing an Atelier interactive painting for a few reasons. First, you want to protect that painting from any of the environmental elements that are out there. And also, varnishing serves to give it an overall sheen, so you can kind of increase its aesthetic appeal if that's what you want. We have two different types of varnish. We have water-based varnishes in a matte, a satin, a gloss, and we have solvent-based varnishes in an invisible, a satin, and a gloss. Either of these can be used on an Atelier interactive painting. The solvent varnishes can also be used on an archival oil painting. Don't want to use water-based varnishes on an oil painting. All right, so we'll move our solvent varnishes out of the way. And I'll show you how you can work with a water-based varnish. What you want to do is you want to first make sure that your interactive painting has cured, and that can be anywhere from a few weeks to, you know, a month or more, depending on how thickly you paint, your humidity, your surface, and what mediums you've added. But when your painting has cured, you want to provide an isolation coat. We would recommend applying a coat or two of the fast medium fixer down on top of your painting. That'll help seal it. It will also give your painting almost an even surface for the next step, which is that varnish layer. I'm going to use our gloss varnish here. Take the top off, this is a new bottle. And what I'm going to do is I want to make sure that I have a nice soft brush that I reserve just for varnishing. And I'm going to pour some off to the side or in a little cup. Take just a little bit. And I'm just going to apply it nice and smooth. I'm not going to overwork it. I'm just pretty much going to do one stroke and not touch. Now these varnishes are going to go on milky, but they are going to dry clear, and they are all going to adjust the sheen depending on what you have chosen. Our satin is the most popular, but I personally prefer the gloss because I like how it brings out the richness of the colors. What I like to do is varnish just as I am, horizontally, so I can kind of control what's happening. I don't want to have all these drips and runs, and also, I'm going to go in one direction, and then I'm going to go in the other direction. So here, I'm just painting from left to right, and then once this has dried, I'm going to go the opposite way. I'm just going to turn my painting around, and then I'm just going to varnish, kind of get any spots that I might have missed. Working in this way, I'll have covered my entire painting. We usually recommend 2 to 3 coats of varnish, and you will see your colors will be enhanced, those transparent darks will be richer, and you will have done the final step to finishing an acrylic painting. If you have any questions or want to learn more information about how to use Atelier Interactive and all of its mediums, by all means, check out our YouTube channel and also check out our website, atelierinteractive.com.